So you're thinking about moving to Pittsburgh? In this video, we are going to blow up all the hype that the national news is trying to sell you. We'll chop it up with Michael Wright from Holland Mortgage and Sam Bauer from Goosehead Insurance to talk all about our shifting market here in Pittsburgh, not nationwide, here in Pittsburgh. And if you stick around to the end, we'll share with you our top tips for buying and selling in this market right now. If this is your first time to the channel and you want to know everything about living in Pittsburgh and the surrounding areas, then subscribe below and tap that bell for notifications so you can be the first to know about our current market here in Pittsburgh. I'm Krista Lorenzo with Coldwell Banker, and I get calls and emails every day from people just like you looking for help on making their move to Pittsburgh, and I absolutely love it. Whether you're moving in 1 week or 1 year, give me a call, shoot me a text, or send me an email so I can help you make a smooth move to Pittsburgh. Okay, so let's look at some headlines that I pulled from the internet today. U.S. housing cools further, with prices down 2.7% from peak.
Fake news.
I'm not seeing that. We don't have any prices going down at all. 21, 22, 23, we have been steady through it all with, you know, increases. So I don't know if you guys are seeing anything or heard anything about prices going down in Pittsburgh.
I have not heard that.
No prices going down in Pittsburgh. Okay. A rush of homes go under contract in January, but it's unlikely to last.
Fake news.
Again, February was skyrocketed compared to January. In my opinion, the beginning of January was a little slow. Once we hit like the end of January and started into February, we were back into multiple offers and craziness.
Yeah, and a lot of March closing, I saw a lot of March closing dates, which means
absolutely. Yeah. It's only going to get busier. Yes. Actually, a lot of my things that went under in February are closing in March. I had like a little longer closings. Okay. Mortgage demand drops as interest rates bounce higher.
Big news? Well, you know. Well, this one's tricky. So I would say we're nowhere near the national level in a decrease.
Okay.
So I'm getting calls all the time for pre-approvals. The question becomes, how long will it take them to find that house, right?
Okay.
Because of the inventory. Would you say that that's a
fair assessment? Yeah, I think we still have the demand for mortgages. We just have low inventory.
Right.
So the buyers are out there. The buyers want to buy. We just have limited inventory, which is what's causing these multiple offer situations. I mean, I had two buyers in multiple offer situations last week. So, okay. Housing market can't find stability long term as rates move up and down like this.
Fake news.
I'm seeing a completely stable market here in Pittsburgh. And I know Pittsburgh is different than the nation. Pittsburgh is really this padded little insulated that, I mean, I've been doing this 23 years and I haven't really seen us in a down market at all. So I don't think we're struggling with stability at all. Are you guys?
I think that now buyers understand that rates are going up and down. There is fluctuation there. So it's not, you know, when we went from 3% to 5.5%, right? It was, you know,
right.
People were taken aback. People stopped for a while. They wanted some time. Now, when you're fluctuating between, you know, 5.875% to 6.5%, you know, you have a 1 point fluctuation right now, possibly, versus 2.5%. So it's easier for a buyer to gauge if the rate goes up 0.5% or 0.125%, how will it affect their payment?
Okay.
So people's buying power isn't being cut.
Renting is terrible. Owning is worse.
Super fake news.
Absolutely. So especially in Pittsburgh, it is one of the few markets nationwide where it is actually more affordable to own a home here than to rent a home here. Have you seen any information with that?
You know, I have, because the way that the housing market is, houses are appreciating, right? And the level at which they're doing that, it's happening faster. And that also means, though, that landlords are increasing rent a lot faster. So over the next 12 months, you could be losing $7,500 worth of equity that you could be gaining by renting and not buying. So do you want to add that to your own portfolio or to your landlords?
Absolutely.
I would want to add it to mine.
Me too. I would say even just like the payment alone, I know somebody who's just looking for an apartment. A two-bedroom apartment was $1,100. My mortgage is $1,100, mm-hmm. you know, on a 2,000 square foot house. So just the payment alone, aside from the appreciation that you have whenever you own your home, I mean,
absolutely. You're paying a mortgage one way or another. Are you going to pay your landlord's mortgage or are you going to pay your own mortgage?
Right. Exactly.
Okay, last one. Housing affordability hits decades low. I don't know what you guys are doing in the rest of the nation, but Pittsburgh consistently ranks one of the most affordable places to live.
Absolutely.
So absolutely fake news as far as housing affordability when it comes to Pittsburgh.
I would even say, like, from my perspective for homeowners insurance, we're one of the lowest homeowners insurance rate areas in the country. So if you're coming from somewhere like Texas where there's hurricanes and a lot of catastrophic losses, or Florida, and you move here, your homeowner's insurance is going to be a fraction of what it costs in some of those higher risk states. So that contributes, I think, to those numbers probably.
Are there hurricanes in Texas?
Yeah.
I did not know
there
that.
Are. Yeah. That's not fake news, right?
No, that's not fake news.
That's legit. I mean, flooding, and then flood insurance is required in a lot of areas there. So it's just, anyway.
Okay.
It's just one of the
reasons.
Interesting. Well, you mean, look at the fact that you have people that I've pre-approved that are paying, like you said, $1,100 in rent for a one or two bedroom apartment. You could get a much larger home for that same payment.
Absolutely.
So decades low for affordability, fake news.
Absolutely. So now let's get into those tips on buying and selling in our current market. So I like for my buyers to know the way that I'm educating my sellers, because they're going to be buying a home from someone who was educated. So one thing I like,
hopefully,
yeah.
If they're clients,
hopefully they're buying clients, a home from someone who was educated. Absolutely. So there are basically three different pricing strategies in this market or in any market. You can price high and the buyer will come in low, and you negotiate to the middle. This is what we're seeing, you know, 10, 15 years ago. This is not what we are seeing now. You can price right in the middle of those comparables and get a good level of interest, some offers, you know, definitely still a seller's market. Or you can price just below that, get a ton of people in the door, and that really drives the price up. So that is what we have really been seeing for a lot of 21, 22. I think at the end of 22 into 23, we saw more sellers pricing with aspirational pricing, not realizing that buyers are really conditioned to go up from that list price. So whenever you price high, buyers think it's already too unaffordable. So it's really important for sellers to price right, but it's really important for buyers to understand that when a seller is pricing, sometimes that price you're looking at, you know, is really what they're thinking is going to be their starting price. So the other thing that it's really important for sellers to do is get professional photos, to get drone photos, and to do vertical video. We're seeing a lot of video for everything, kind of like location. It's video. So obviously whenever, you know, a seller lists, it goes in the multi-list with Coldwell Banker, and with myself, it goes on over 700 different websites, and we do all kinds of different advertising to hit all those different social medias. The other thing I like to do is when it goes on the market, I like to wait a few days before we start showings, just to kind of build up that appointment book. The buyers get excited, and they, when they get to the house, see other people there, creates a lot more sense of urgency. So when we combine that sense of urgency with that anxiousness, they really come in with good, strong offer. And that's how we sell with top dollar in just a few days. On the buyer side of it, it's really important that we present an awesome offer. Like the end of last year, we started seeing buyers asking for a little bit more, but as the inventory lessened and the buyer pool increased, as they got comfortable with those interest rates, we are back to multiple offers, so you really have to come in with a strong offer. One of the most important things when you're putting in a strong offer is to make sure you are working with a trusted lender. So when I put an offer in, I copy Michael on it, and, you know, to the other agent, I say, this is who I work with. She gets it done. You know, you can have a wonderful offer, but if they're not going to close it, it doesn't matter. So it's really important that you work with someone you trust and that the buyer feels so comfortable with their payment. So that's why we really do that pre-approval, you know, and have all that done up front. The other thing a buyer wants to make sure they have is a good amount of hand money. So hand money shows the seller that you have some skin in the game. It shows them you're serious. So if you have mortgage and inspection contingencies, if we don't successfully negotiate through that, you get that hand money back. The only way you lose it is if you would just up and walk away. So speaking of inspections, it's real important, and now we are back to inspections, thank goodness. Even though we're in multiple offers, we are back to inspections.
Your insurance agent is happy about that.
Absolutely. So as we're doing those inspections, we're also checking for insurability and seeing what that's gonna cost. Make sure there's nothing, no claims in the past that they didn't know about or anything like that. And with those inspections, there's a whole range. Like, if it's a really competitive offer and you don't want to waive inspections, but you don't want to, you know, say full inspections when other people are waiving them, you could say, hey, we're going to have inspections, but we're not going to ask for the first $3,000 in repairs. You know, we're not looking to nickel and dime you. We just want to know if there's anything major wrong with the property, you know. So the other thing is it's really important to have a realtor that has the relationships, not only with lenders and insurers, but also with other agents. Whenever I put in an offer, my reputation comes along with that offer. So it's not like I just started. They can see that I have a history of closing houses. They can see that I have a history of working together, making it a win-win for everyone and getting it closed. So it's going to be real important to you to find people for your team that work well together and get it done.
What if people undervalue sometimes the reputation that the realtor has, right? So somebody that has experience, somebody that gets along well with their peers, really important, because again, it's not just a team atmosphere from insurance to mortgages and the buyer's agent, but being a team with the listing agent, we're working towards one goal, right? Of making multiple people happy in a transaction.
Absolutely.
So I just feel like people don't understand that value quite enough.
I think that's really true. And on the seller side and on the buyer side, I've had my buyers win offers because I have worked with that agent in the past and they know I'm going to get it done. They know my team is going to get it done and that we are going to do it in a positive way that's a win-win for everyone.
And maybe we put in there too the fact that it's not, I mean, you get your experience, you get along with your peers, but you're also full-time. So there's so many part-time agents that maybe they can take a call, but they're at their other job.
Yes.
You know what I mean? What kind of relationship can you build with the listing agent and with the other people involved if you're not?
I've had a couple of those lately, and I've presented an offer, and they're like, I'll call you when I'm done with work. And I'm like, what do you mean? isn't calling me part of work, but they actually have another job and they're just doing this after that, which, you know, that's great.
Absolutely.
It's just important. In this market, you need someone who is there all the time. And like I said, whether you're moving in 1 week or 1 year, give me a call, shoot me a text, or send me an email so I can help you make a smooth move to Pittsburgh. Until next time, I hope to show you around town.